In the realm of contemporary music, only a select few artists possess the ability to push boundaries, defy conventions, and create sonic masterpieces that resonate across generations. Frank Ocean is one of those artists. When talking about amazing songwriting skills in R&B music, it's hard to think of any current artist with a pen as good as Frank Ocean. He has a near flawless discography, but there's one song to me that showcases this skill like no other, and that song is Pyramids. Pyramids was released as the second single off Frank's debut album, Channel Orange. Unlike Nostalgia Ultra, that was largely built on samples of other songs, Channel Orange was Frank Ocean coming into his own, and Pyramids to me is just the best representation of that energy. In fact, there's a strong argument for this being one of his greatest songs. From the story to the structure and the composition, everything is just so well built. It's one song that illustrates what Frank knows how to do best in the most grandiose way possible, which is an almost 10-minute odyssey capturing the unchanging, ceaseless cycle of human desire. It's maximalist and beautiful, and because of that, it stands out. On this song, Frank follows a cinematic approach to songwriting, which isn't completely new, but he does it so well. He crafts a narrative that seamlessly weaves together the past and the present. Cleopatra's legacy, symbolizing power and desire, merges with the narrative of a stripper in modern-day Las Vegas. The song begins in ancient Egypt, through the perspective of an imagined lover to Cleopatra. And in the opening lines of this song, this person is frantic and believes that Cleopatra has been kidnapped by an unknown thief.
Said that cheetah's on the loose. There's a thief out on the moon.
Now, the fact that this person is a lover to Cleopatra is still presumed, because we know nothing about this figure yet. But the way they commanded authority, sending cheetahs out like bloodhounds to find their lost owner, makes it seem like they're some sort of ruler. Or more specifically, a pharaoh. Now, my favorite thing about Frank's songwriting on this song is how open Frank leaves it for interpretation. There's intentional loose ends and vague moments which allow for multiple different interpretations. Now, everyone has heard the name Cleopatra, the famed Egyptian queen and last ruler of the Ptolemaic dynasty, who lived from 70 BC to 30 BC, according to history. But what's interesting about this story so far is that the real Cleopatra actually didn't have a co-ruler of Pharaoh at her side. So from this point, Frank makes it clear that Cleopatra in this story represents someone else.
They have taken Cleopatra, run, Cleopatra, come back for my glory, bring her back to me.
Now, Cleopatra's lover sends out a rescue team to find her and bring her back for his glory. On first listen or glance, this line might seem surface level, but the phrase "for his glory" means something deeper. The name Cleopatra comes from the Greek words kleos and patra, which means glory to the father. This line gives a sort of identity to the formerly unknown figure, calling for her rescue in the intro. The facts are still hazy, but we now know that the phrase "my glory" attests to this person being a noteworthy, dignified ruler who would have his entire reputation destroyed by having his queen snatched away from him. The song moves on, and in the first verse, the perspective switches to the alleged thief who stole Cleopatra. Through promises of a better life than she already had, the thief somehow convinced Cleopatra to abandon her kingdom and run away with him.
We'll run to the future, shining like diamonds in a rocky world. Rocky world, our skin like bronze and our hair like cashmere. As we march to the rhythm on the palace floor.
Now, what's interesting is that in ancient Egypt, like many royal houses, members of the Ptolemaic dynasty often married within the family to preserve the purity of their bloodline. So historically, Cleopatra was traditionally married to her younger brothers, Ptolemy XII and XIII. But despite this, A large part of her legacy involves her romantic affairs with Roman generals Julius Caesar and Mark Antony. Cleopatra met Julius Caesar, who was the dictator of the Roman Empire after fleeing Egypt because of her brother. She initially sought his help to regain her throne, but the two ended up becoming lovers. After Julius Caesar was murdered in 44 BC, Cleopatra had another affair with Mark Antony, another Roman general. It's a relationship that dented Cleopatra's reputation because Mark Antony wanted Egypt as Roman territory, which is how they crossed paths in the first place. In this verse also, the thief refers to the pyramids, the location he fantasizes with Cleopatra about, like it's personal property, something that they would love to possess in the future. This kind of gives a clue as to who the thief might be, although it's still a little complicated, because it could be one of the two men, or it could be completely fictional and another man altogether. Now, another thing about Frank's songwriting that I love is how well he's able to craft stories. And a big part of that is how he's able to detach himself from the story while still using the story as a vessel to express his thoughts and feelings. It's just like how movie directors and writers can create stories and characters that aren't necessarily about them, but still contain an essence of their experiences. I think that's an interesting way to talk about his thoughts, feelings, and the things he's been through. It's one of those little details that make Frank, Frank. As he once said, "The work is not me. I like the anonymity that directors can have about their films. Even though it's my voice, I'm a storyteller." In the second verse, the focus shifts back to the imagined former lover of Cleopatra. His perspective on the whole situation has now changed, as he is now aware Cleopatra actually ran away by her own will. He paints a picture of her as a fallen jewel, once precious but now tarnished, a metaphor for her ruined reputation. And he's also torn at the fact that she not only abandoned her throne, but left him for someone else.
What good is a jewel that ain't still precious? How could you run off on me? How could you run off on us? You feel like God inside that gold. I found you laying down Samson in his full head of hair.
Now it gets a little interesting here because Frank mentions finding her in bed with Samson and also interestingly mentions his head full of hair. Now there's only one historical figure that matches this description, and that's the biblical character Samson, who was betrayed by Delilah, who took away his source of strength by cutting his hair. But historically, Cleopatra and Samson existed in two entirely different timelines. Merging these two timelines is obviously an intentional move by Frank in the context of the larger narrative. One of the central themes in the story of Samson is deceit, and Frank references this story in the wake of Cleopatra's betrayal to refer to his idea of the women in his life, or at least in this storyline, being deceitful by nature. In this song though, an important Easter egg is that Samson still has his long hair intact, which means he's still yet to face the inevitable betrayal by Delilah, tricking him, cutting his hair, and taking away his strength. Cleopatra, in this case like Delilah, has a track record of turning her back on the men in her life, and her former lover in the second verse makes this clear, implying that Samson, the current man Cleopatra is with, will eventually face betrayal just like he did in the future. Now on the outro of the first part, Frank refers to the cheetahs once again, like he did in the first verse, but he sends them to a different location this time, a tomb. Giving the context of the story so far, the word cheetahs in this verse could mean something different this time, and it's probably a play on the similar sounding word cheater.
No more she lives, no, I'm a serpent in that room. Oh, no more, he has killed Cleopatra, Cleopatra.
It's a popular belief that Cleopatra committed suicide by allowing a snake to bite and kill her with its poisonous venom, and her former lover alludes to this story in this verse. Snakes also symbolize disloyalty and betrayal, so Cleopatra's death mentioned here is both literal and figurative. It's basically a metaphor to describe how the person he once knew doesn't exist anymore. Notice, he he actually never says she died. He says she lives no more and he has killed Cleopatra. While a real snake killed the actual Cleopatra, her decision to leave here has killed the relationship. The song transitions from the first half into the second with a beat switch. Now, this is one technique that Frank Ocean has used a lot in his music. We've heard it all the way from his first project, Nostalgia Ultra, on the song There Will Be Tears. We also heard it on Blonde on the song Nikes. We also heard this technique on Ninth, where he uses it to split Blonde into two separate parts. And he also had one on Future, Free, and Pretty Sweet off the same album. But there's a way Frank uses the beat switch on this song that's genius to me. It's almost like an intermission in the story, segueing into the next act, which is supposed to bring more clarity to the overall plot. Now, Act 2 brings us all the way from a distant Egyptian past to the present. What's also interesting is that this second half of the story begins from the perspective of someone who seems to be a pimp. The Egyptian past in the first part of the song seemed to have been a dream, as this person wakes up next to a girl he nicknames Cleopatra, who's getting dressed to go to work at a strip club called The Pyramid.
Big sun coming strong through the motel blinds, wake up to your girl, for now let's call her Cleopatra, Cleopatra. I'll watch you fix your hair, then put your panties on in the mirror, Cleopatra, then your lipstick, Cleopatra, then your 6-inch heels catcher. She's headed to the pyramid.
Now there is an interesting juxtaposition between the first act and the second. The prestigious pyramids of Egypt have been reduced to a strip club. And in some way, the same thing happened to Cleopatra, who went from the queen of an entire kingdom to a stripper. Also, notice how this person refers to Cleopatra in the opening lines as your girl. With this line, Frank gives us a clue who this person is. The phrase your girl could point to the pimp being the thief that took Cleopatra from her former lover in the first part of the song. Now remember how the thief referred to the pyramids in the first act.
As we march to the rhythm on the palace floor.
What's interesting is that if you hear that line again with the context we have now, it almost sounds like he was describing a club scene. I also love how at that moment, the production also changes to reflect that. It's basically foreshadowing in a very clever sense, and I think that's another reason why I think so highly of Frank Ocean's songwriting. He's so intentional with every word. There's another juxtaposition in this verse that's interesting too. Listen to the way he paints a vivid picture of his current reality. He wants us to believe he's living lavishly and tries to convince us of this using very detailed imagery, even though the current setting says otherwise. He's sipping champagne with jazz playing in the background, but he's still in a motel. But somehow he tries to convince us that because he's on the top floor, it's lavish anyways.
Pimping in my convo. Bubbles in my champagne, let it be some jazz playing. Top floor motel suite, twisting my cigars. Floor model TV with the VCR guy.
He also has a chain full of rubies and owns a luxury car with wood grain interior, but there is no gas in the tank. By mentioning both the pyramids and the strip, Frank most likely hints to Cleopatra working at the Luxor in Las Vegas. The Luxor is one of the world's most notable casinos, with a striking black pyramid structure. With this part, the pieces of the puzzle the story has been so far start to come together. The first part of the song was an elaborate metaphor for how the narrator of this story fell in love with a woman who eventually left him. And we start to see a connection between Cleopatra in the first half and a modern day representation of Cleopatra. This narrative is particularly interesting because it draws a connection between the historical Cleopatra, who sought help from Julius Caesar in exchange for intimacy to regain her throne, and a modern day Cleopatra, who engages in similar transactions for money. Both women left their original partners to be with other people, and while the first part was from the original partner's perspective, this second part is from the other lover's perspective. What happened in the dreamlike past in Frank's elaborate metaphor actually represents what's happening right now. The story is not over yet though, and for one last time, Frank presents another plot twist, with the perspective of a person who seems to be another lover of this modern version of Cleopatra.
You showed up after work, I'm bathing your body, touch you in places only I know. You're wetting your warm just like a bath water. Can we make love before you go? The way you say my name makes me feel like I'm that nigga, but I'm still unemployed.
Remember how the pimp in the last verse kept referring to Cleopatra as your girl? He was probably referring to this person when he said that. We also find out that this guy is still having sexual relations with Cleopatra. Now, out of all the verses in this song, this particular one was the hardest by far to decipher. And that's because it opens the door to the possibility of multiple different storylines, which creates a dilemma. Now, I've come up with a few possible narratives of what this verse could mean, and I'd love to know which one you guys think fits best or is more likely to be accurate. Now, the first potential scenario I considered is that this individual used to be in a romantic relationship with Cleopatra, but Cleopatra left them for the pimp. And this theory is because of one line that stands out to me in this verse. This line is a key puzzle piece in the larger story, in my opinion, because Frank chooses to highlight the fact that this man is unemployed. And it's not just in the words, but how he says it. You can literally feel his insecurity as a man without a job in today's society. And tying to the general narrative, this could have been the reason why Cleopatra might have left the relationship to start sex work in the first place, because her partner could no longer provide and meet her needs. If you think about it, this narrative mirrors Cleopatra in the first act, who left the relationship for an unknown reason other than the fact that her new lover promised her more than what she already had. But as we go further into the verse, another line once again stands out and opens the door to multiple different storylines.
Say it's big, but you take it. Right, cowgirl, but your love ain't free no more, baby. But your love ain't free no more. She's working out here tonight.
From this line, we're presented with the possibility that this man's relationship with Cleopatra is no longer romantic, since you're no longer together, but is now transactional. And the only reason he's in bed with Cleopatra right now is because he paid for it in order to relive his fantasies. Since he's now been reduced to paying Cleopatra for sex, he clings on to every moment of intimacy he can get from her, deluding himself into believing he still has romantic attachments with her. Now, a second narrative that I also thought about is that Cleopatra could still be in a relationship with this guy, but with a very twisted dynamic. In order to sustain his connection with Cleopatra and have his sexual desires met, especially because he's unemployed, he has to pay the price of her love, which in this case is having to live with the fact that his partner is now under the control of another man and relies on sex work with other men to bring in the money. Notice how he goes straight from "your love ain't free no more" to "she's working at the pyramid tonight." This implies that the reason Cleopatra's love isn't free anymore has to do with her job at the strip club. That line could also mean that because he doesn't contribute financially to the relationship anymore, he feels insecure about not being able to provide. He sees the power balance shifting and thinks he needs more money to maintain control. It's almost like he's saying, "I need to earn more to keep you because your love isn't something I can have without money anymore." Let me know which narrative makes the most sense to you in the comments, or if you have an alternate one, I'd love to see that also. One last interesting thing I noticed after a few listens is that towards the end of the song, Frank switches from standard English to African American vernacular English. It's interesting that his delivery also mirrors the plot of the entire story, and I think it's genius how this change is another way to compare the past to the present, not just in the words he uses, but also in the way he says them. Again, the most beautiful thing about Frank's songwriting is how he intentionally makes parts of the story vague, so there is room for multiple interpretations of what the larger narrative of the entire story could be. In my opinion, this song is a commentary on the state of modern society and relationships. It dissects the nuances of human nature and our constant yearning and desire for more, which leads us to make decisions that might end up being detrimental in the long run. The narrative also also reveals how society has twisted the essence of love and relationships. Cleopatra ran away from what was a seemingly perfect situation and abandoned her throne because she sought the one thing her relationship didn't already have, love. Cleopatra's initial Egyptian lover claimed to love and care for Cleopatra, but treated her like an item to show off. Notice how he kept referring to her as a precious jewel and to bring her back for his glory. It was clear from his words that his intent to show her off was driven by his desire for his own personal acclaim. The thief saw Cleopatra's charm and status and knew he could profit from it. The second verse mirrors his ambitions, exposing his desire not only for Cleopatra herself, but also for control over her kingdom, a conquest to be achieved through a relationship with her. His perspective was grounded in materialistic goals and scarcely echoed any actual love for Cleopatra herself. Instead, it revolved around her possessions. Then there was the pimp, who saw Cleopatra as a way to make money to keep his bills paid. And the last guy, who seemingly loved and adored Cleopatra, actually desired her body above everything and wanted power over it at all costs, even if it was to his detriment. Although, one thing to note is that even though Cleopatra left all these men for different reasons, the last guy, at least, seemed to let her make her own choices. Despite all wanting different things, the underlying motive for everyone in this story was consistently rooted in the pursuit of power and control. They all saw each other as a means to an end, and the lack of genuine love in every relationship dynamic in this story parallels the dynamic of modern-day relationships. Someone called the song the Bohemian Rhapsody of our generation, and I think there's some truth to that statement. Frank Ocean seamlessly goes back and forth between ballad-like singing and melodic rapping while weaving an intricate storyline all in one song. And what's equally impressive is the way he keeps us on the edge of our seats the entire time. We're constantly waiting for the next turn in the storyline, and Frank changes his cadence and delivery, and even switches up the production style to hold our attention. Pyramids is undeniably a masterpiece, and this song is one of the main reasons why I consider Frank Ocean one of the greatest artists of our generation.